My role in my own heart and the reason why I was there is that I needed to speak the truth.
I had to educate myself. Personally, I'm pro-vaccination, but having to sack people because they don't take a vaccination is, in my book, just immoral.
Like a river that is flowing, where you know.
This is the world that we're in now. You better toe the line. But we wouldn't.
No, I need to do this. I feel so strongly about it. But I'm proud of what I did and what I fought for.
The Wellington protest was that light. It gave me that faith back that maybe we don't have to go down that dark road.
This was where our power was. I just wanted to get one night on the whenua, and if we'd have got through that, I was happy.
If the politicians of New Zealand think that these little games that they're playing against us up against some of the most resourceful people in New Zealand, they're dreaming.
Give them an umbrella!
I think I understood, because I listen. Your job as a politician is to represent the people.
This leadership group had a person offered to negotiate. I just assumed the government would behave reasonably.
If democracy is a conversation and politicians don't want to have the conversation, what are we all doing here?
Be calm, everyone. Peace and love.
How can you be an anti-vaxxer when you had a vaccine? You know, like you did it, right? You're not an anti-vaxxer, you're an injured person.
We'd already been bullied out of everything else. I didn't have anything else to lose.
Made me cry every day they didn't come.
Where's your mana?
Kumari e, whakalawa lahi atu, Elliot Ikilei here. It is my pleasure to welcome you to have a bit of a chit-chat with our special guest. It is such an amazing movie, a film that has touched so many people in such a short amount of time. Anyway, I want to just be the platform. There is great, great things to speak on and just really exciting time. So without further ado, I want to bring in the producer of the River of Freedom film. This is Jared Connon. Jared, whakalawa atu, how are you?
Kia ora, Elliot. I'm very good. Good to see you all.
Awesome. And just for our team who are watching, please don't forget, share. Feel free to chuck in any sort of comments and any sort of messages you want to put forward. We will do our best to bring it into the show. We may even have an interloper coming in halfway through the program as well. So this is just we want to find out the film, the movie. We want to know what's happened. There's been some exciting news we've heard. But Jared, would you be able to just, you know, start off us? The film has now been released. What is your first impressions of the reaction? And, well, what do you think? How did it go?
My first reaction has been humbling, you know, to be honest. You know, from the moment the film, you know, was released, you know, during our premieres and then into, you know, theatres across the country, the feedback and response we got from our audiences was phenomenal. It was powerful. You know, we were receiving many, many emails, social media messages, and just, you know, comments from people that we knew personally. When we'd bump into them, they were just all very, very moved by the film. They were very appreciative of the film being released, you know, and they also experienced what you know, what a lot of people couldn't do, and that was that they were transported into the heart of the protest, which was, you know, the tagline we gave the film as well, because that's what we could see in it when we finished making the film. It was very much, you know, taking people, you know, putting them right there amongst it all with everybody else, and you know, the story is very much a story of the heart and from our heart as well.
Well, it really is, and I get a little bit geeky here because from my point of view, I'm a bit of a history I love history. I find the stories really fascinating and the nuances engaged in it. And with the film, what I saw was the story being told, a factual, detailed story, not shying away from what happened at the end and looking at the different pieces of the puzzle, so to speak, and utilizing footage as well as testimony and, of course, the raw footage that we saw out there. I have to say, even people who were pro mandates during the mandates, I have discussed within work, and they actually are turning around. And I have to say, I'm not without the hint of flattery, the film that you have been a part of, I think, is starting to become more of a historical document as opposed to a wonderful film, which it is. It's heartwarming and heartbreaking at the same time, but it is a historical element. Do you think that in the future it could be quite an important part of New Zealand history and, dare I say, in education in this?
Well, it already is. You know, every film you make is, makes its place, finds its place in history. I think the importance of our film is that, it was able to take the voices of the people who weren't able to share their stories openly or with any sort of meaning beyond, each other. No mainstream media was picking up the story. They wanted to shut our voices down, and everybody there just had their own truth, and the film really, portrayed to me my experience, what I saw and what I felt and what I lived while I was there. And also our director, Gaylene, she did an amazing job editing that film together, and sharing her story as well and everybody's story. It was a story that everybody was really familiar with. So I think that's also, what has been the profound impact of it. Definitely a document of record for New Zealand's history, that's for sure. It's been mentioned many times by many people. Some people have seen it and said they didn't realize, how much impact those mandates has had, on the people who were at the protest. So it was, beneficial to share that story, and hear it as, as you expressed it, Elliot, their testimony, that was it. It was, you can't deny what they're saying. They're just speaking from their hearts. They're speaking, with their truth, and they just want to be heard, and we all wanted to be heard. So, the film's really been able to do that for us, get it out there. And also, like you say, it's been an opportunity to open a door for a lot of people to come and, engage in that conversation with people they might have shied away from, speaking about it with before. So there has been a lot coming together, which was the intention of the film. It was always meant to be a bridge, so people could come back together and start to talk about these subjects, in a respectful manner rather than just, mudslinging, and name calling and belittling people for, their decisions.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, it was quite a well-known time because, and this actually gets shown in the film, and is that dehumanization of those who are the unvaxxed, those who chose to be unvaccinated, who fought and were actually quite vilified. There was a great deal of discrimination put to those people, as well as a saturation of messaging that showed a very dehumanization tactic that was there. Quite fascinating. Now, and I think you're right, because I do, and I desperately desire for a forgiveness element. And when I speak about it, and I'll be honest, most of my circles are those who are anti-mandate, and so they'd love the film. When I discuss with them the ideas of forgiveness, very quickly, there is a lot of pain and struggle that's still there in the heart. I think this film has a cathartic edge to it, and I think that it is necessary for us to somehow start a conversation between what the government did, which was split side by side and then have one side being attacked for. I am desperately, because I know that so many want the words accountability, a reckoning, judgment. These are the words that I am hearing more and more. And as the facts are going to be, already are starting to come out about the fact of the negative aspects around it, I think a film like this will have the ability to mend hearts or start that conversation where we can start to heal each other. And so I think it's powerful.
I was gonna say the accountability thing is actually very important to a lot of people, The Reckoning. But I don't think it needs to be, you know, doesn't need to be put across with the dark cloud of doom or menace, you know, that it's often associated with. But you know, I want to make inroads in my own industry with people and organizations to say, yeah, a reckoning and an accountability to actually acknowledge what happened, and to, you know, to understand what happened as well for a lot of us. Because again, it's back to that thing that a lot of us have never been able to have that conversation to sort of share the hurt, the pain, the anger, the frustration, the loss, you know, that was experienced by the government's mandates. And they were very, very deep wounds, you know, for a lot of us that haven't healed. But, you know, every day we, you know, it's, you know, live in light, you know, look forward and figure out a way of, you know, of moving, you know, to a better place together is, you know, but, you know, in that there does need to be some accountability and some kind of, you know, yeah, for want of a better word, the reckoning of it.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. Now, you know, the film started, and I believe it was in 9 cinemas. You mentioned also before that mainstream media just refused to pick this up. There was a very interesting one, because you had Sound of Freedom, which was very similar in terms of the mainstream media were trying to ignore it, didn't want to have a part of it. Then you had the River of Freedom. I don't know. I don't want to get all spooky or anything like that, but I just found it really fascinating that two films that were absolutely ignored by the mainstream media, the taxpayer-funded, supported media, and there was, in actual fact, both films have done remarkably well. Can you tell us what's an update? Has it stuck to the 9? And I might be wrong, I believe it did start off with the 9 cinemas and independent cinemas, and now what's the deal? What's happened with it since?
So we've ended up with being able to, you know, share the film and with over 50 different cinema exhibitors.
50.
Yeah, we got up to 50, thanks to our very you know, amazing distribution team of one. So, you know, we've, you know, Heidi's done an amazing job getting the film out there across the country. Last weekend, it was only, still only playing in 30 cinemas. So while we've, you know, we've hit 50, some of them have stopped playing it over the school holidays. You know, you know, they need to get the Paw Patrol movies out there, but they're going to pick it up again after the school holidays. So we have consistently sat, you know, between number 10 and number 13 in the box office. You know, we've had a really high screen average, which is, you know, which is what's, you know, very telling about the audience, in that we've only had a small number of screens, but we've had a very high number of sales per screen. So while the big movies are making big numbers, they've got, you know, 3-4 times the number of screens that we've been able to reach. So, yeah, we're doing, you know, really, you know, great numbers for a small independent film self-distributed across the country. So, yeah, we're into week 4 now. We haven't finished week 4, but we're still going strong. And, you know, a lot of the cinemas are still, you know, say it's a great business. You know, it's doing great business for us. So we want to keep playing it.
Yeah, awesome. Awesome. And that's it. That's that wonderful sort of angle of capitalism. Capitalism engaging, hey, love it. I love
it. Yeah, we keep saying, yeah, the irony's not lost on us. The fact that we were those of us who were cast out of society, you know, for not following the rules, and now suddenly we're, you know, we're making money for you all.
Yeah, right. Sheesh. And so, yeah, it's been wonderful. We've something actually came up, and I was really excited about this as well. Can you help us understand this? Because I saw this coming up, and this is what appeared, and it's got a fat number one on there. Happy, happy. Tell us. Can you explain this for us? What is this number one going on? What's this number one?
We did hit number one in the New Zealand box office for one day.
Ho!
You only need to be number one. we started the week. The cinema week starts on a Thursday. So on that Thursday, it was set Thursday the 21st of September. I remember it well. My mother and my daughter's birthday as well.
Oh.
And we were the number one film, you know, on that day. You know, it was day one out of 7 days, admittedly. So by the end of the week, we had, you know, taken our usual spot of around about number 10, but being number one was, you know, it was just a huge moment for us, all of us, everybody, you know, who had been part of not only making the film, but who had been there at the protest as well. because it was just an acknowledgement of everything that we've been through together. The audience had come out, you know, had come to see the film, had shared it with family and friends, and you know, that was reflected in a number that nobody could ever deny again, because you know, it's there in the history books as well. So you know, huge response, and you know, across the country we're really thankful for the people that came out to see the film and support us.
Oh, well done. Yeah, great job. Now, also, we've had some reviews coming on, and I just want to give our people out there just a quick look as to what are the little snapshots of after the film. So, team, check this out.
Hello, everyone. Just an incredible night tonight, watching The River of Freedom.
That was a powerful film, world class.
It touches something beyond a documentary.
The movie was so heartwarming. It was absolutely phenomenal.
And it was a reminder of what's still happening today and the things that still need to be worked on.
I thought it was portrayed honestly from both sides.
They have told a truthful story.
I think the world needs to see how our government treated the people, because it's not acceptable.
I hope everyone can see it. It really is. It's the truth.
Go and watch it. You have to, because it gives an insight of what really actually happened there.
After watching the movie especially, I'm like, yes, this is a country that I can be proud of.
What was captured was such a true representation of what it felt to be there.
This needs to be seen by every New Zealander.
I just encourage everybody to go and see it, because really it's a part of our history that we will never forget.
Absolutely, a part of our history that we will never forget. I think that's probably really well said. Jared, have there been other people, have there been any surprises? I'm curious, have there been other surprise reviews? Anyone who sort of said, oh, great video, great film, great movie, but it's been a bit of a surprise one, or have they all been people who, you know, were well in the circle and everything like that?
No, it was, you know, the biggest surprise for us was getting a really good review from Stuff. Graham Tuckett there went to see the film, and he openly says, I never supported the protest or what the people were there for or you know what was being said there, but he said at the end of the day it's an important film. You know, these people have not had their voice heard, and it's a very good film, and it's a film that everybody should see. You know, so that was really it was just kind of mind-blowing at the end of the day for us. It was, we woke up to find that on a Sunday morning. So, of course, we shared it, and, we couldn't. There was, you know, aspects of it that were still, you know, hadn't managed to sort of, you know, find that bridge that we'd put out there for them. But, we still appreciated, you know, getting some acknowledgement in mainstream media. But nobody else in mainstream has bothered to review the film. Graham opened the review with the best line ever. He goes, I went down to buy a ticket and I couldn't find one because it was sold out, so I had to wait 5 days until there were some seats available. So the best way a reviewer should start there, you know, anything. So yeah. It was
wicked. No, awesome. And we do have some of these in here. And this is, you know, you've got Graham Ticket. There you go. Yeah. Took me a week to get a ticket. Film sold out as well as exactly what you were just saying. You know, five straight days in Wellington. This afternoon session I got into was also a sellout. I mean, come on. You know, I mean, for Stuff to actually do that. Yeah. You've also got Graham Adams. He's from The Platform. Gailing Barr's River Freedom documentary is a vivid and atmospheric portrayal of one of the most polarizing events in New Zealand's recent history. Absolutely right.
Yeah.
Right. Then we also had the Dane Gerald. 2.5 running time, maybe daunted by the prospect. Film rarely lags. I gotta say, the whole movie just really it was over within 5 minutes, as far as I'm concerned. You know, it felt like that. It doesn't feel like you're watching a film. It really doesn't. You've been parachuted into the middle of the protest and are experiencing it firsthand. I think that might be my favorite one. And then this one here, Sean Plunkett from The Platform. There's a movie you should see no matter where you stand on vaxxers. If you are a New Zealander, if you are interested in our democracy, you must see River of Freedom. And the last one that I've got there, that we have there is River Freedom Doco, documentary strikes an emphatic tone and is packed with emotional testimony from a range of dissident voices. And I think that is, I think that's extraordinarily, that's some powerful stuff. And like you said, you know, you're getting Tuckett from mainstream media stuff, no less, who have some problematic issues in terms of their own political leanings. You know, yeah. I think it was wonderful. Dane's one, I think, is probably closest to what I felt, because when I went in there and I did feel like, you know, I was parachuted in there. I was a bit of a behind the scenes guy. I was sort of directing crew around from my little landline, and I was sort of behind the scenes sending people off to little parts of Wellington, as well as in the convoy. But that film just transports you right in there. It does parachute you, absolutely. There's that dropping in feel of you just land in it and then you're a part of it. And it's just, I forgot, I didn't realize, but maybe I was so inert over the past 2 years, but it felt the trepidation, the fear, the anxiety, the heartbreaking moments, it was all in there. It was brought back. And I think that's why there were so many tears there was in there. How did you feel seeing it, even on that first night, watching it and being a part of people?
It's thrilling to be a part of that. To share it with a huge audience is such a unique experience, especially on the premiere nights, that very first night. You have your own interpretation of the film as a filmmaker. You've watched it many times. You've been, you know, needling over details, figuring out which parts you're just going to have to let go and go, well, that's just where we run out of time. We can't keep, you know, trying to finesse this little bit here. But, you know, when you take it in there and you sort of, you know, share it with, you know, and we literally had, you know, over 1,000 people there, hearing their, you know, their gasps, their cheers, you know, the clapping, the laughing, you know, it was just, you know, it's a whole new experience because...
The booze!
Yeah. Because you kind of miss that when you're making it to a degree. You sort of go, oh yeah, and you have your own impression of it. But when you share it, when it's a shared experience, like the protest itself, it's just has so much more, you know, depth to it. So it was beautiful just being there with family and friends, and even, you know, again, just seeing that video of you know, everybody's reactions after the film. So many friends, you know, of mine that were there who became friends because of the protest. You know, some of them were camping next to me, some of them were the musicians, some of the people that I met just through the process of trying to put this film together. And you know, it's just, you know, it's beautiful. And every time I've seen it since, it was just got, you know, another layer of beauty was, you know, imbued into the film for me, because it was with a different audience and people came out and just wanted to share different stories. And you know, it was really, really special. As I said, you know, a couple of times in the premieres, the first film I've produced, and I'm really proud to have this on my CV as, you know, my first film. You know, it's couldn't be anything better.
Gosh. So that was your first film?
Well, it's not the first film I've worked on. It's the first film I've produced. So as a producer.
Oh, wow.
So I've put films together and I've sort of been in the industry for, you know, over 30 years. But as a producer, you know, the buck stops with you at the end of the day. You know, you're partnered up with a director and, you know, you're on a journey together. Yeah, and I couldn't have asked for a better partner than Gaylene. You know, she's a phenomenal, you know, artist, person, you know, friend, you know, and I really appreciate everything that she's done in support of me as well, you know, to help us get here together. So, yeah, it's pretty special, you know, and I'll never forget it. You never forget any film you make, but this one is, you know, very, very, you know, dear to my heart for many, many reasons, as you know.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is I would regard this, I don't want to be, I will. I think this was a civil rights film. That's what I think this was. This was a civil rights film. When I look at when I've studied up on the various elements around Jim Crow law, around some of the elements around British empiricism, I think this was, I think it was civil rights. But I also have, we've got a bit of an interloper coming in. Someone's trying to hack into the system, which is a bit of a problem. So we better bring them on, otherwise they're going to get all angry. So ladies and gentlemen, welcome to stage one of the stars of the film, River of Freedom, Liel Tilsley. Liel, start
no,
over.
Not the star. Hi, Elliot. Hi, Jared. Finally, hey, say hello to you.
It's an honor to be able to share the screen with you as well tonight. Thank you for joining
Yay.
Us.
Yeah.
See, awesome. Liel, look, thank you for coming in. Really good to have you here. What are your thoughts? Because, of course, you were right in there watching the film. You went to the premiere. You were, I believe, you were in one of the couple of front rows. thoughts on that first night? How did you resolve anything? What came up? What your feelings? Your first hit feelings on terms of it?
I was very emotional. And I kind of couldn't remember what I had actually said with the interview because it was so long ago, but it was still so relevant to the night. And Gaylene just put it together so beautifully and weaved it all together. And it was a very emotional night because, you know, being there for quite a big chunk of the time there, I understood the feeling of the of how the documentary was done. And oh my gosh, it still feels a little bit emotional to realize that actually you're part of a history that, you know, things could have gone so differently if we hadn't have been there, but also to be able to capture it with so many people was so beautiful. And I really wanted to say hello to Jared because I don't think I've actually met you otherwise.
No, I don't think we have. I know you were there on at the Auckland premiere, but I don't know if we actually got a chance to hug. And
I know there were so many people around you guys, so I thought I'll just sneak on out. But
Liel, favorite part? You know, have you got any part which sort of maybe not favorite, but what? Was there a part on there, and I know there were many different parts, but was there a part on there that particularly touched your heart?
Yeah, there was, because I was there for 18 days and I had left on the Sunday, so I wasn't even there for the last part of it. And it was to see our kuia and our kaumatuas stay in the tent, you know, really actually, there was just a strength in them that I was just like, I love you guys so much. That was my favorite part, I have to say. You know,
We had to keep that one quiet for a long time. You know, when we discovered that footage and the story that came with it, it was pretty powerful. And we, you know, Gaylene spotted it and said, you know, basically this needs to be the end of our film. She was with our composer, Russell Walder, and they watched it. And realizing that was the moment of the protest, you know, that we held our ground, you know, we were the last one standing, you know, we were there, you know, the police moved past us. So it was, and then of course, every time you do an interview, you don't want to say it because you don't want to let it out for people who haven't seen the film, but it's, you know, a really special moment.
Yeah, that was definitely my favorite.
I would have to say my favorite's a bit, possibly a bit odd. That would be the convoy for myself, was the convoy from all the different areas coming in. And I don't generally tear up on film and movies, but I actually teared up on those scenes because I was watching yellow and brown and red and black and white, and I was watching Hare Krishnas and Christians and some Muslims. I was watching people whose vehicles, I think that's where I teared up, weird, but beautiful vehicles, and then thuggery ones which were never going to get a warrant of fitness at all. I saw buses and even sneakily saw some trucks branded trucks that were, you know, beeping out there supporting, quiet, trying to be quiet in their support. But New Zealand was on the sides of the roads, and New Zealand was on the bridges overlooking. New Zealand was giving water and food. New Zealand was holding hands and hugging and crying. That was New Zealand, and that convoy. The film captures it so heartbreakingly beautiful from both ends coming down and then meeting, whether at Precton or even Wellington. Jared, in terms of the different footage available, some of that would have been had to have been gotten from different people. was it taken from different people, and was it easy enough to grab a hold of?
So Gaylene and our cinematographer, Mark Lapwood, they travelled, you know, North Island, South Island, you know, from the Cape and from Bluff, you know, to come to meet together at the protest. So a lot of that footage of the convoy was captured by themselves. But then, you know, as we got through the end of the protest and we had done all our own filming, and we had at one point we had 7 cameras running, you know, throughout the protest ourselves, just amongst our little team. But, you know, even at the end of it, we still put out word to say, has anybody else got any footage that they want to share with us? You know, by all means, get in contact and let us know. And so a lot of people started sending us things. So we slowly built up a database in the library of all that footage. And then it was Gaylene's job to really sort through it, because it's one thing having all the footage, but she needed to, you know, work out what the narrative was. What's the story? And the story did change, yeah, you know, numerous times when you're going through that process, because there are so many facets to what was happening that, you know, it took a lot of time to really hone what, you know, the message was. You know, we always knew why we were there, but it's the delivery of that message and trying to make it, you know, as efficient and but as impactful as possible, you know, was the job. So we were really always, you know, just super blessed by all the footage that was given to us and shared with us. And, a lot of people, you know, gave us huge amounts of it, and we only used small snippets of it just to help tell that story. So, it was a challenge, you know, there's no doubt about it. And I think our first cut, I think Gaylene had it at about sort of 5.5 hours or something like that. So it was, and there's still so much story to tell. We've often talked about it on our end as well. It could easily be turned into, you know, a number of 1-hour episodes for a documentary TV series, because there's so much conversation that was had, so many different ideas and issues were sort of, you know, put on the table at various times. But it was a lot, and, you know, it was always amazing to have, you know, a lens everywhere. We had cameras everywhere at the end of the day, and that's what was so fantastic.
Yeah, and I think that is actually a great idea to have it as multiple part sort of documentary. I think that would be wonderful, man. I'd be glued to that sort of thing. Yeah. Not just because of the heartfelt, and also because we happen to be on a particular side, but just that historical element and the fact of where it fits in New Zealand history. I think it would be wonderful to put that. And I have to say, if you did have all that footage, you know, Gaylene having that ability to craft a narrative from that storyline was absolutely gorgeous. Like I said, I do enjoy that history element. And you guys were able to put through everything, as far as I could see. You were able to put through every element from the get-go, from the start, from that political positioning of Miss Ardern and the other academics who were put in place. It crafted an ability to take us on that journey as to where it happened, the incremental pushes towards what we would regard as some authoritarian behaviors. So I think it was just a wow job. Look, we've nearly come to the end, but I've got one more big question to ask. Liao, is there anything that you'd like to ask, or perhaps a comment that you'd like to give at this stage?
Yeah, Jared, I was wondering why they didn't play vaccination. Honestly, that was the worst song ever.
Which one was vaccination?
And they had, vaccination. Oh,
the rap.
Yeah, the rap. And they had David Seymour, and, you know, it was hilarious. I was thinking would have been funny to have that. But actually, no, I really appreciated you know, being able to go through, and the things that were said, you know, from all different directions, was again just so beautifully weaved together.
And a lot of people are still coming back as soon as they've seen the film. They send us those messages as well, so we really appreciate everybody's, you know, heartfelt, you know, responses to the film. And and we know a lot of people are going back and for repeat viewings as well. So we keep hearing from people who've been back 3 times, 4 times, taking friends and taking family. And that for us is the most important thing, is, you know, is getting the message out there. And, you know, as you would have experienced, Liao, and other people have, it's I think the other thing that's really special about the film is that we're able to see it in theatres as well. And it's, you know, we do spend a lot of time looking at our computers and looking at our devices and that. So it's, you know, we've started putting something together as well. We've been out and we've been speaking to the exhibitors, you know, the cinema owners, and hearing their stories, because they've been hugely impacted by it as well. They've just, you know, they've been really, really moved by the audience's engagement in the film and the community coming togetherness of it. And, you know, it's the thing of, you know, people, I've been seeing, you know, people write messages below in the live stream there, just talking about the conversations that happen after the film, you know, and one cinema owner was telling me about the conversations that people are having with his staff. You know, they're really encouraging, and it's just, so that's what it is as well. It's like, it's beyond just getting a film out. It's also bringing people together again, which is, you know, it's really special, and that's the beauty of cinema, and we hope we never lose it. You know, the world's changed a lot, as we know, but, you know, I've really loved getting out there and, you know, just speaking with those owners. I was in Wanaka with my family for the school holidays. And we went down to the cinema and we spoke to the owner there, and he'd been playing the film, and he was just, you know, just thanking us, just, you know, thank you so much for making such a beautiful film about New Zealand. And, you know, the audience has been loving it. So good on you, you know, do something more.
Wow.
Good, good.
I think just seeing the people respond, like I've never seen it at any theatre I've ever been to, where people have responded to each part of the film. So, you know, you might get an odd clap at the end, but nothing like this. Nothing, you know, it almost felt a little bit of what was happening down in Wellington during that time. Mm-hmm. It's just this whole togetherness of, oh my gosh, we feel it, and so we're going to respond to it. And because we haven't, even that guy that said something about don't tell my mother, you know, don't tell my mother I'm here, you know, just the being able to laugh, being able to cry, being able to, you know, speak out loud is something that I don't think we've seen for a very, very, very long time. So
no, and that just was the experience of the protest when we all came together. We were all just like, wow, look, here we are. We're all back together again. We've been cut off, you know, cast out of society, and we all came together at the protest, and we suddenly felt, you know, our hearts and spirits lifted, and we were encouraged, and we were connected again, you know. And so it's been very much that process for everybody coming back to the cinemas, you know, to see River of Freedom. So, you know, we want more people to see it. It's still playing, so get out there and, you know, experience it, take new people along. You know, we're not done yet, everybody. We've still got you know, we've got lots of screens playing it around the country. So, you know, if people want to find out where it is playing, they can always go to our website, you know, which is riveroffreedomfilm.nz. So, you know, pop along there and find out where it's playing.
Awesome.
Someone's just asked, when is it coming to Australia?
Yeah, I've just seen that one. Sorry? Huh? Give it to us. When is it coming to Australia?
Oh, well, that's what we're working on at the moment. You know, we know there's a big audience there in Australia. And we've been trying to find a distributor. We haven't managed to find anybody willing to pick it up. So we're, you know, going back to self-distribution models again and seeing what we can do ourselves. You know, so we're starting by approaching theatres, and, you know, we've got a lot of inquiries that have come in to us, you know, via email and through our website. So we're looking to follow up on all of that. Hopefully we get it there before Christmas, but not too sure. We'll, you know, stay tuned. Subscribe to the website.
Awesome. Now, here's my last question. The timing. While I think that you are not generally political, the film is inherently political. Oh, we just lost him. Did we lose him on accident? Yeah.
No, he literally fell off. You can ask me. Then. Go on, ask me.
I don't know if I want to ask. Are you unbiased in this situation there, Liao?
No, completely not unbiased.
We'll ask it, and hopefully we'll get the man back on. Jared will come back in. But, yeah, you know what? I will, because I want to know. This is, of course, a political film. It's not political because it's trying to be... Oh, here we go.
There he is.
There he is.
Sorry. He was like, I'm done with politics. I'm out.
Yeah.
Well, I was more worried about black bags being put over heads or something like that, you know? Yes.
You watch too many movies.
All right, Jared, I want to know, this movie is inherently political. Even if it's not being done for a political reason, it is inherently political because of how the whole thing went down. We have a freedom community who are absolutely fractured. They are very fractured. And I know that I'm asking someone who doesn't push that much. I'm just wondering of your thoughts on this. You've got Democracy NZ, Freedoms NZ. You've got New Zealand Loyal. You've got Leighton Baker Party. You've got all these different parties. And it seems to be that now the Freedom, we're attempting to try to coalesce under some type of umbrella. Now they look, to me, it looks as if they may be starting to move towards New Zealand First for pragmatic reasons, not so much desire-based reasons. What's your take on the political situation and where your film comes into play with it? What do you think about the Freedom community and the political parties who are out there?
My perspective on the situation at the moment is it's still very early days for us, in the freedom movement, in the political space. So I think there's a lot of time, to try and form a party that is more that is going to speak to everybody's needs, because at the moment the multiple small parties have all got their agendas and have all got they're on a mission, and I've got my heart's with a lot of them, with all of them, and I go, I don't know which one I would like to go with the most of all as well, because it's not it hasn't been sort of formed up into a collective group that can sort of really make an impact in the parliament at the moment. But I think that'll come. I think there's a shift happening, and it may not be in this election, but perhaps the next election, that there'll be more strength in our numbers, more alignment. It's at the end of the day, it's just fantastic to see people out there speaking, speaking the words and doing the work to get into parliament. And I think there's a lot of hope out there for those of us who have sort of lost a lot of faith in this, in the system, so to speak. I don't believe in the current system myself is working, but I'd like to think it's got there's going to be some changes in it in the future. But I'm not a politically astute academic or expert to sort of know where that all goes or what's the best situation. I can only I just follow my heart at the moment. I'm doing my own reading, and like everybody should, they should all sort of put their vote where they want it to count the most at the end of the day. As much as I don't want to vote in the because you just go, can't we have a better situation than what we're doing at the moment? At the end of the day, I still want to be able to say, I still want to be able to call up or send an email to the person I voted for and say, you're not doing what I expected from you, because you said this was going to happen. So
100%.
Everybody is just I really appreciate everybody out there who's standing up to be counted. That's for sure. It's no mean feat. It's a hard graft getting up to election day, that's for sure. It's almost harder than making the film.
Oh, yes. Wonderful. Wonderful. Yes, and Liao will know that. I'm sure we'll be having a chat with Liao if we are, especially quite soon on that discussion. But look, thank you so much for coming in, Jared. We're absolutely so humbled by you joining us and having a discussion on it. We love it. We want to see more of it, and we want to pump this up as much as we can, because for myself, it's less of a movie as it is a historical look at what happened at probably the most contentious time and perhaps even authoritarian time than we've ever had in this nation. So I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart, at least as a Kiwi among Kiwis, for putting this together, for making it work, and for getting it out there for people to be having a great time. But I want to say thank you so much for that.
That's awesome.
Thank you. Thank you.
Can I just say one thing before we go? The one thing that I came away from the movie when I walked away, I just, in my heart, I was like, we cannot have those who were in government be there anymore. That's how I felt walking away. All the people that didn't come out to see the people, you know, minister means to serve, and nobody came out. I just felt in my heart, not one of you deserve to be back in Parliament. So this is our chance. This is our moment to change things. Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
So thank you, Jared.
All right.
I've got one last thing to say, and I have to admit that's the reason why I lost my connection there, because I was quickly scrambling going, you know what, I said our I gave out the wrong website address for our film. I was quickly clicking on the slide going, I know I said it wrong, and it's because I actually said our Telegram handle. So apologies to those of us watching, because somebody will be messaging me very shortly saying you got the website wrong. So our website is riveroffreedom.nz. So yeah, you'll find us there, riveroffreedom.nz. That's where you'll find the screenings and all the information about the film. So thanks everybody. Thanks Elliot. Great to see you, Liao. You know,
lovely to see you.
Thank you so much for your contributions to the film as well, Liao. You know, you're a massive part of it, and we really appreciate, you know, everything you said in the film.
Thank you so much. Yeah.
God bless you all. We'll see you again real soon.
Okay. Bye-bye.